they used meditation technique. Actually, Buddha discarded most of this technique and he discovered this meditation technique, what is called vipassana, in which case we can understand the ultimate truth of this world. So then you will get away from suffering forever. That is the whole idea in that meditation thing. But the point is this. Imagine when 63 people are having different opinions or the techniques about how the mind can be developed. So Buddha was basically in 340 BC or whatever, as I roughly remember. So then during that time, there was that much of development in relation to spiritual or the intellectual development. So then I basically plan for after this point, because I rushed it. I thought I did not have enough time because I came a little late. There was no actually way that I could get away from that place, because Gyan and myself, we have to be there. Now I will briefly take this philosophy of science slide also and give you some idea about what I will be talking in the future lecture about the epistemology, metaphysics, ethics and logic. Then after this, maybe 5 to 10 minutes duration, we can have our discussion. You can ask various questions. Then I will try my best to answer, because normally in this kind of forum, when people ask questions, we have various or diverse opinion. Sometimes what we say may not be what you are expecting. So therefore, it will be interesting actually if it goes in the correct direction. So then I basically want to discuss in my second lecture about this philosophy of science part. Dr. Nalin mentioned about this mathematics, I wanted to mention the difference between science and maths in that part. Can one of you basically give me some idea about, as you think, what is the difference of science and maths? In our university system, mathematics departments are also located in science faculties. So therefore, sometimes we have a misconception that maths and the science are the same, but they are fundamentally different.
Once proved, mathematics theory can be changed. Mathematics. Science evolves, but mathematics theories are proved and will not change.
Okay. Yeah, I think what you are trying to say has some elements for the answer, that it's very interesting that anyway you can also have a different opinion. That one Philip Kitcher, actually he has mentioned about this part when I was reading my thing during my studies, that in maths actually whenever you develop a new theory, you never break the older theories. You, on top of the older theory, you always develop maths. Because of the new arrival of new theories, older theories are not falsified. This is what you call a priorism. But in science, actually, anyway, you come up with a new theory, you always find some limitations or you disprove older theories. Okay. So then these two subjects are fundamentally different, the way they develop the knowledge into the subject of mathematics and subject of science. They are different. So then both are using logic and that kind of thing. That's a different story altogether. But it's a bit interesting to notice about mathematics and difference of mathematics and science. So in this context, actually, I don't know whether you have heard of Russell, because Russell is dead against about this scientific method, where you do experiments, then collect large number of observations. Based on that observations, you come to conclusion. That is what we do in science. Scientific method is that. So you set up your hypothesis and other thing, then eventually what you do experiments based on a large number of observations, you finally conclude what is your theory or what is your finding. This what you call the method of induction. Inductive reasoning is in science. I think I have a little time, I can briefly tell about this Russell's turkey example. I don't know whether you have heard of it. But to disprove scientific method, actually he has given very nice example. So that whole idea about the Russell Stack example in the Western culture, actually in Sri Lanka also we have those. We have a big chicken called turkey. Okay, assume that there is a person then who bought a baby turkey, say in November, in 1 month or whatever, 1 year, and now he look after that turkey. So turkey has a small cage at home, so then every day this person is feeding turkey. So now it is December, so during winter actually, December, January and so on. Now turkey noticed that every day at 8 o'clock in the morning, turkey is given meal by the master. So now it goes like this. So then turkey is collecting evidence. So after the winter, so then now it is approaching June or whatever. During that time, actually you are approaching summer. Then now turkey is noticing that not only in the winter, now in the summer also I am getting meal at 8 o'clock in the morning. Then sometime it noticed that when master goes somewhere, then he assigned that feeding part to his wife or somebody else at home. Then turkey has even more evidence now telling, even in absence of the master, I am getting my meal at 8 o'clock in the morning. So this is what we do in science. So then we collect large number of evidence under different conditions and the environment. So then in December, first 2 weeks, early morning at 8 o'clock, turkey get the meal. So then 24th December also master goes to the turkey and give meal at 8 o'clock. But 25th master goes to the kitchen, turkey, and cut the neck for the Christmas meal. So then until such time, actually all the observation-based conclusion that master gives me my meal 8 o'clock in the morning every day, that scientific theory is true. Inductively you can say. So, but actually induction, the problem with the induction, you don't know what will happen the next morning. So he said that because he is a very strong mathematician and logician, therefore he basically wanted to disprove the scientific reasoning by giving that example. Okay? Right. So then we also have to talk about this Karl Popper and Thomas Kuhn as the two major person. Other scholars will also be talking about these two persons anyway, but I'll be talking in a slightly different manner where you can use their definitions and other things for your purpose without that much actually giving trouble for your head. Sometimes understanding those things and discussing those things in detail is a bit of a tiring task. So then major areas, so I am just giving you some idea about what I'll be talking next. Major areas of philosophy of science, this epistemology, metaphysics, ethics and the logics. These three are basically considered as sometimes some kind of cornerstones in philosophy area. The best example I ever got for this one, that if you consider Newtonian theory kind of thing, Newton look at the world in terms of force, mass, acceleration and so on. This is where your epistemological ideas come in. And when you say metaphysics, whole idea is you try to build the structures out of the concepts. You have F equals ma. That is not F divided by m is, F into force into acceleration is mass. No, that kind of what is you are getting is putting the concepts into structures. This is where this metaphysics, so ontology is coming in. So then you have the ethics. That's a bit of lengthy topic again. Even when you actually talk of this, how to write your literature review, ethic in research is there. So then for the reasoning part or inference making part, in all kind of knowledge system we use logic. So then with this actually I want to conclude my presentation. Now, floor is open for discussion, then you can disprove what I said, then you can enrich me with your ideas and so on. Okay, then. Thank you very much.